Welcome to the Veritas Forum, engaging university students and faculty in discussions about life's hardest questions and the relevance of Jesus Christ to all of life.
Many students at Berkeley are here because they're motivated to succeed. In many ways, whether they aspire to an academic career or to one behind the ivory tower, both of our speakers in some way embody that success. Professor Lee, you have an endowed chair in management at the Graduate School of Business at Stanford University and are a senior academic fellow of the Asian Bureau of Financial and Economic Research and co-founder of Nippon Capital LLC. I'm really saying this for the benefit of everybody else in the audience, okay. Professor Odean, you also have an endowed chair right here on campus at the Haas School of Business. You are also on the editorial advisory of many boards, including the Journal of Investment Consulting, the Russell Sage Behavioral Economics Roundtable, and also are an expert panelist for the Wall Street Journal. So both of you operate in the world of business and finance. The questions I'm going to be asking you tonight are a broad set of questions loosely organized around the relationship between God, happiness, success, and money. How are they related and about our ability to pursue them? So to start us off, Cal students come from an extremely diverse cultural and religious backgrounds. Can you share a bit about your own cultural and religious background and how you have come to the religious views that you currently hold? And how do you think your cultural and religious views affect your personal and professional lives? Professor Lee?
Oh, okay. Hi, I can't see any of you.
Oh, thank you. So I've been told that it takes a little bit of courage for a Stanford Cardinal to show up here. So thank you for your hospitality and not throwing anything hard, and I'm grateful. I think I find some measure of comfort in having received, when I received this this invitation, to know that actually my dialogue partner, Professor Odean, is someone I've known for 25 years. And I consider a very good friend. So I felt like at least if the two of us had a good conversation, you happen just to be listening in, that it would be all right. So let me give you a little bit of background on myself. I was born in Taiwan. My parents were from mainland China. So they were only in Taiwan long enough to have three kids, and then we immigrated to North America. So I'm MIT, like made in Taiwan. So, but after that, I grew up in Canada, so I speak a little bit of Mandarin, but I am pretty, I guess, North American in terms of cultural orientation. And I grew up in Canada, and I did my graduate school at Cornell University. And then for a number of years, I taught in the Northeast. I taught in Michigan and Cornell. Came out here, I thought, for a short-term leave in 2004, and didn't go back. So caught the California bug or something, so stayed here. In terms of my religious background, my parents were not Christians. When I grew up, my mom first became a Christian, I think maybe when I was maybe a teenager or something like that. My father was an atheist. Since my dad was the smartest person I knew, I grew up kind of confused. So by the time I got to college, I think I sort of had a kind of like a truce with God. You know, I wasn't ready to say that he didn't exist, but I also didn't know much about him, and I figured that if just because I don't believe in him, he's going to send me to hell or someplace unpleasant, then that kind of God I wouldn't believe in anyway. So I figured if I just try my best, I should be all right. And plus, I think growing up in Canada, there were a lot of interesting things for you know, for a growing boy. So there was, you know, photography and chess and fishing and girls and, you know, stuff like that later. So I really didn't think much about it. And I think it's only after I went to college, I think it was about my third or fourth year, a number of things happened in my life that made me rethink whether or not God existed. One of them was that my father had cancer. So, and he had a series of operations. And the other was that I found I had a few broken relationships. So broken romances, that's what the nicest way to put it. You know, sometimes it was somebody else's fault, sometimes it was my fault, but the process made me realize that there were a lot of things in my life that I couldn't control, things that were important, things like my own anger, my rage, my lust. There were many things that are important that I just wasn't in control of. And it started made me to think again about existence of God, purpose of life, and things like that. And it was after I graduated, when I was 24, that I had, I became a Christian. I had a conversion experience. It was in the summer. It was a Christian camp. And I don't know how much time we have, but I'll just tell you that right around then, I had this very, very thorough, very holistic conversion. And that had made all the difference in my life. I had not, as I look back on it, it's been 34 years, something like that. And it had a dramatic effect on the career I chose to go on, the things I decided to study, the choices I've made, the lady I married, everything. So I look forward to sharing that with you.
All right. Is this on? Yes. No.
No.
Okay. Trade deal. All right. I'm Terry Odean. I had a different sort of life. Okay. I grew up in Minnesota, and I grew up in a Roman Catholic household. My parents, particularly my mother, were very religious. When I was 14, I went to a Benedictine seminary. It probably sounds a little odd these days, but for many, many, probably centuries, I keep thinking this is good feedback. For many centuries, 13, 14-year-old boys went to seminaries. My uncle went to a Franciscan seminary when he was 13 and spent his life as a Franciscan friar. Didn't work out quite the same for me. When I was 17, I left the seminary, I left the Catholic Church, and I've been an atheist ever since then. But religion is, in a way, it's a combination of dogma and practice. And I rejected the dogma, but in some ways retained a lot of the practice. So my sense of what was right and wrong didn't change. My belief that helping others is important didn't change. And in an odd way, even my life today is somewhat reminiscent of what it was like when I was young. When I was in the seminary, we got up every morning and we went to Mass. These days, I get up every morning, I sit and I meditate for 40 minutes. When I was in the seminary, every spring we had a three-day, allegedly silent, not particularly silent, retreat. These days, every year, one of the highlights of my year is I go off to a week-long, actually silent, silent retreat. So I teach here at Cal. I dropped out of college 5 months before graduation in 1971, and I came back to college at Cal. I enrolled in Cal about 17 years later, and stayed in long enough to actually to finish and get a PhD and So all my degrees are from Cal, and I'm lucky enough to be teaching here. And I would say certainly my cultural values affect both my research and my teaching. One example is I'm currently working on trying to develop an online course on personal finance that'll be free and available to the public. And my hope is that at least that might be helpful to some people. I'm not optimistic enough to think it'll necessarily help a lot, but that's what motivated me to take on that course.
Thank you. And Professor Lee, did you want to talk a little bit about how your cultural and religious views affect your professional life in particular?
Sure. So I think it's very difficult for us to separate the way we live from some of the more basic things that we believe in life. I think we all need to have some basic framework in which we view reality. So we all need to have answers to questions that the security guard asks you at night, you know, when he encounters you. You know, who are you? What are you doing here? Where are you going? What are you up to? And these are the basic questions that I think we start having when we are 4 or 5 years old. They continue to be, we recognize, the first order questions of our lives. And for me, it was a very big change when I became a Christian. I suddenly started to realize that there is a purpose, that there is a place. And some people, you know, I'm not a Christian because it's a crutch or it makes me, you know, it's when life is hard, I need a painkiller or something like that. I'm a Christian because I think I see the world more clearly through those lenses. I see who I am, why I'm here, and the purpose of my life. I see reality, why I am the way I am, why I make the silly, stupid things, the mistakes that I make. I see that more clearly through those lenses, and the choices I make about whether to be an asset manager or a professor, all of these things are affected by that. And even the topics that I study, which maybe later will come up.
Okay, so now that we have a better picture of both of your backgrounds, I'm going to get into a few of the more specific questions. And since you two are very good friends, please feel free to engage with each other. You don't have to speak through a moderator if you don't want to. I don't think I've ever felt more like a third wheel in a conversation before.
I've always had a lot of anthropology questions that I wanted answered.
Okay, so first question. Do you... do you believe a moral or economic vision is the foundation for the American dream? What would you say to students who feel the American dream is something that is handed out primarily on the basis of privilege? Professor Odean, would you like to start?
Sure. I think the American dream is basically an economic dream. It's the idea that you can prosper in America through hard work and ability regardless of your social and economic origins. And it's to some extent in danger of becoming a myth. There was a study published in the American Economic Review a couple of years ago that looked at occupational mobility in the late 1800s in the US and in Great Britain. And at the time, there was a lot more mobility in the US. But by the mid-1900s, the differences were very small. And if anything, today there's more opportunity for economic mobility in Western Europe. If you're a man in the US today and your father was in the bottom 20% of the income distribution, there's a 42% chance that you're also going to be in the bottom 20%. In Great Britain, that would only be a 30% chance. And in Denmark, it's only a 25% chance. There's a lot more mobility, you know, a lot more chance to move up. And sort of a corollary to the American dream is this idea that every generation is going to live more prosperously than their parents did. And that's also come under a lot of pressure in recent decades. So the median wage for white men in the US in 2014 was about $37,500. Adjusting for inflation, back in 1973, it was $42,500. So it's dropped $5,000. Now, some demographic groups have done better, but basically everybody living in the bottom half of the economy has not seen that dream of each generation having a better life. Now, so as not to be totally glum, I'd like to point out we are here at the greatest public university in the world. And in fact, the biggest driver of social mobility and economic mobility is public education. And particularly, you know, state-funded colleges and universities. That's the ride up, and you all have a chance to take it. But it's also coming under threat. We really need the states to continue supporting public education, or else that part of the American dream is going to be stifled by student debt.
Okay, so American dream. I think the American dream, in quotes, has been an idea that's been embraced not just by Americans, but by people around the world. And I think it does have some economic overtones to it, the idea that you can make a better life for yourself and for your children, I think is a big part of it. But I think like with all good things in life, there is a moral dimension to it. There is good, there is, you know, good sex, bad sex. There's good power, bad power. American dream, really, when you think about it, there is a moral imperative. There's a side of it that's something about justice, something about opportunity for all. I think the world embraces it that way. The thing that's worth protecting is that. You could have good times and bad times. The pie could be bigger or smaller, but there is this notion that there is a meritocracy and there's opportunity. I think that I agree with Terry that some of that might be eroding, and therefore leaves us with an imperative in terms of what to do with it. I should also point out that some of these aspirations that the American dream embodies is not just country specific. It's this really human desire to aspire to something bigger and better, and that's a very universal thing.
Okay, just chip in. I also agree about the moral imperative that Martin Luther King wrote in his letter from Birmingham jail about that the people who were protesting and sitting at the lunch counters and getting arrested were defending the American dream and this, you know, that and extending it, you know, trying to extend it to more people. So I do think there's, if we want that sort of a society, there's a moral imperative to make it happen and not just sit by and watch it go away. Mm-hmm.
Do you both think that there's a direct relationship between the moral and economic vision of the American dream?
Direct relationship, I mean, positive.
No, sorry.
Significant statistic.
No, coefficient of correlation.
Okay, moving on.
um, That worked pretty well, you know. It gets hard from here on, we know.
Okay. Given your understanding of human identity and behavior, using insights from your fields and your life experiences, how would you define success? In particular, as business faculty, how do you understand the role of wealth in successfully making meaning in people's lives? Do you think it is helpful or harmful?
So success, and then the relationship between success and wealth, and is wealth even good? Is that the idea?
Yes.
You get to define the idea.
Okay, all right. All right, so you want me to start? Or do you want me? Okay, so,
yes,
so all right, so success, right? Success. We're here to talk about success. So we all want to be successful, right? No? Yes? Success, is that a good thing? Yeah? Who doesn't want to be successful? You just raise your hand so I can see you. Right? We all want to be successful, right? But what about being a successful liar? Or a successful thief? Or a successful terrorist? Right? When you think about what success is, success simply means the attainment of a goal, right? You're successful because you attained a goal. The more basic question is whether the goal is a worthwhile goal. Right? So the success of a knife is to cut because it was designed to cut. The success of a racehorse is to run because it was bred to run. You know, the success, you know, of a Cal football coach, you know. Well, let me say it's Stanford football coach. So yeah, you know, win the Rose Bowl, beat Stanford, you know. So here it is, right? What about success for a human being? You know, what makes a human being successful has to do with how you view what a human being is, right? You need a framework, you need a context in which to think about what is a life well lived. And I think we all have some, to some degree. We may have different beliefs, we may have different faiths, but I think the university is where we should have these types of conversations, right? Because we all have, we need some sort of a cogent, you know, commitment to a certain metaphysical view of reality. Okay? We need to use that framework to make decisions, to weigh choices in life. And we do already. Even if your answer to all of this is, you know, I don't know. I mean, I've got 70, 80 years, 90, and that's it. And I don't really know what comes after that, and I don't really care. So I'm just going to optimize for the 70 or 80. That's a decision. That is a medical commitment to a certain metaphysical worldview, right? We all have those. And even if you don't say it outright, the way you make decisions reveals them. So for me, as a Christian, I believe I'm created by God. I'm a creature. And so... So the way I calibrate how I'm doing is with reference to my creator and what I know about him. And what I'm responsible for is to try to understand, to know, to love him. And that has consequences for how I treat people around me, how I view the value of human life, and a variety of other things. Am I getting close to answering questions? So, you know, I mean, success. So success. And the other part was wealth.
Sure,
right?
The word success was in there.
That sounded like a good word.
Are you asking me if you successfully answered the question?
So I set a goal and I attained it. So.
Should I repeat the question?
No, I'm just going to make up an answer anyhow.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Basically, you know, given your understanding of human identity and behavior, how would you, using insights from your field, how would you define success, and how do you understand the role of wealth in making meaning in people's lives?
Well, okay, I'll take the half part, the last part.
The wealth
in making meaning in people's life, and I actually think wealth is very important in making meaning in people's lives. But it's not because billionaires have more meaningful lives than millionaires, but because it's hard to live in poverty. And I think that it's important for us, if we want people to lead meaningful lives, it's important to try to eliminate poverty and improve access to education. And for those of you who exert efforts in that direction, I think you will make other people's lives more meaningful while making your own more meaningful. So, you know, wealth does matter, but not, it doesn't matter to end up, it's not like he who dies with the most wins. It's that, you know, helping other, I think there's a lot of value to helping other people lead better lives.
Okay, all right, so we both teach people how to manage their money and stuff like that. So you'd expect us to say, you know, wealth matters, right? So I'd have to totally agree with that. but I should also, I feel obligated to point out that, you know, the book that I'm very fond of, the Bible, you know, it's not Finance 101.
Where can you get a copy?
Yeah.
Amazon.
I think that's a good place. So it's not Finance 101, but you'd be surprised at how much Jesus talked about money. So in the New Testament, every 10 verses mentions money. Every 10, in the Gospels, the four Gospels, right? And 16 out of Jesus' 38 stories is about money. So if I were to give you the elevator pitch, you know, the MBAs are fond of elevator pitches. You know, it's like the 15-second summary of the whole world. So if I were to give you the elevator pitch of what Jesus says about money, it basically says, it's not what you think. it's not. Yeah, okay. It's not yours. Okay. It belongs to God. Okay. It's not reliable because ultimately it's not going to be what you think it's going to be when you really need it. And then it's not you. Okay. So basically what Jesus says is you are not your money. Don't get confused. When you start tallying, that ain't where you count. That's not where you start. In fact, you are not your resume, okay? Because there's something more important in you than money. He refers, so we don't use the word soul very often these days, at least not on the campuses that I've been at. But the word soul is a really important word. I mean, in the Old Testament, it shows up like over like 750 some times, right? The word nefesh, which means soul, right? The Bible keeps saying that you are more than the sum of your atomic parts. There's a piece of you called a soul. And this piece is really important. And Jesus says it over and over again. And today, we spend a lot of time focused on money because we are very focused on the body and the physical and the present. But the teachings from long ago and generations before us focused on something else. Like in the Old Testament, there's a passage that says God took the dust of the ground and formed man, and then he breathed into his nostril the breath of life, and he became a living soul. Okay, so all the ingredients, you know, the same thing as the stuff on the dust, right? All the chemical stuff. But there was some other thing that happened in a very intimate act. He became a living soul. And then Jesus says, for what is the profit of man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul, right? So what I'm worried about, and the reason why I'm willing to, you know, come to your fair campus and other campuses like this, is because I discovered that in these days, right, we have become a university, as a university, we spent a lot of time talking about how to, like how to make money, how to become good electrical engineers, and how to become good chemists. So we spend a lot of time on sectoral knowledge of the how-tos, but we have not spent enough time on the integration of knowledge. We might just call it wisdom. We don't talk about it. We don't talk about wisdom, which is the application of knowledge to live well. And I understand why, because sometimes it's a little bit, well, controversial, right? People get upset when you start talking about values and good and bad and morals and God and stuff like that. But these are the important questions. And from where I come from, not not addressing your soul needs does not make those needs go away. They just fester. And we see it in the pressure that students have, the suicides that we have in some of our best schools, even in the high schools around where I live. We have people who have a hard time evaluating who they are apart from their resume. I think that's enormously sad and perhaps partially an institutional failure because we have so privatized the things that matter to us, our faith, and we just don't talk about it. But those are the important things. Not that I think money isn't important. I teach people how to manage money, right? But I do think that we also need to look a little past that and think about priorities. Yeah.
Did you want to respond to it or
no,
to go away?
So yeah, actually, you know, one of the happiest people I knew was my uncle Bob, who became a Franciscan friar, and the Franciscans take a vow of poverty, and they actually take it pretty seriously. I doubt if he legally owned anything other than his clothes. But it was a voluntary vow. It was life he chose. I do believe still, it's very hard for people who are struggling in poverty and didn't say, this is where I'm choosing to be. So a lot of money doesn't make you a lot happier, but a little bit does a lot of good.
Agreed. I'm supposed to be indifferent, but.
Give it a try.
It's nice when the vow of poverty is optional.
It's not that popular these days either.
Right. Well, I'd like to ask you both. I mean, you're both a position where you're meeting a lot of students for whom the question of accumulating wealth is one that is very important to them, that they definitely might prioritize in their life. You both have opinions where you can see that, given your different faith and moral backgrounds, that you see that it's not all about money. How do you communicate that to students, whether formally or informally? I mean, where do you see that fitting into your relationship with your students, you know, on and off or off the curriculum?
That wasn't one of the prepared questions, was it?
So how do we convey our sense of what is important, not important, to our students, right?
Because I got to tell you, I get a lot of business students or, you know, people in other majors taking intro to archaeology as an AC requirement, and it's very clear that
you can tell their business school students.
I can tell because I have a sheet that tells me their major.
Oh, it's not because of their behavior.
I'm being nice. I'm kidding, but no, they come to my office hours and they tell me point blank, you know, they're trying to get into Haas, they're worried about their GPAs.
That doesn't happen in anthropology.
not to the same extent, okay. So we'll say. But no, I mean these are clearly students that are very motivated to succeed. They're able to pursue a goal but perhaps that goal isn't the best goal to have. And I can try to talk to them, but then again, I'm just an anthro graduate student. You know, what can you offer your students as, you know, professors with endowed chairs?
You mean other than coming to conferences, coming to sessions like this and talk about life?
Yeah, yeah. Other than that.
So,
it's a good start.
I don't know how to systematize it as part of a curriculum. I do think, though, that we should have regular conversations like this one I do think that we over-sanction ourselves when it comes to these types of topics. I think the how-tos are important, but the whys are even more important. A university is supposed to be a place where we have these conversations. I think that in terms of working the curriculum, I think most of my students know my faith orientation. I don't think I preach in my classroom, but I think that you do convey what's important to you in various ways. Aside from that, I think it's reasonable when someone makes a proposition and you're not sure that it's entirely true to simply repeat that proposition and ask if that's what they mean and whether they think that's really true. I think it's okay to do that. If someone tells you that, I think, for example, that, I don't know who I am other than my resume, but I do know that if I maximize resume, you know, I get a better job, get a more attractive wife, blah, blah, right? Then you can have a conversation about that. We can have a conversation about why, what is important. You're only here for 70, 80 years. A lot of the stuff that you think are valuable are not going to be very valuable in a while. So whose face is on the $10 bill? Very good. I shouldn't have asked you. I should cold call. So who is Alexander Hamilton? Excellent. Secretary of Treasury? Way back with, right? Anything else?
Yeah, how did he die?
How did he die? Oh, yeah, this is a good question. How did he die? You know, I very recently saw a 60-minute clip on him, so it's like I'm bummed up. Did you see the same one?
No, my father was an American history teacher.
Oh. Here's the thing, right? Here's the thing. Like, we try to do so many things in life, right? And suppose you're really successful, and you end up with your picture on the $10 bill, right?
Yeah,
and
a bullet in your heart.
That's pretty good. I mean, this is success, right? You know, this is success. This is Alexander Hamilton, right? So, what was his favorite color?
Green. Obviously.
That was a reasonable guess, but I'm going to assume you guessed. So
I would assume she's right.
What made him cry? What made him, what did he love? What mattered to him? Who are his three favorite people? We don't know. And frankly, we don't care.
Read the biography.
Yeah, read the biography. So here's the point, right? We work really, really hard to succeed. And when we succeed, you have to ask yourself, what is it you succeeded at? And why does it matter? You need a metaphysical framework of reality, a cogent sense of what matters and what doesn't matter to make those decisions, right? You need wisdom. What's wisdom? Wisdom is, I don't know, it's to esteem that which is worthy of esteem, to value that which is worthy of value. But how do you do that? You must have a framework. You must have a way of evaluating investments. I don't mean dollar investments, but life investments, right? I mean, right now, the most popular course in undergraduate at Stanford, it didn't even exist 5 or 6 years ago, is now the most popular. It's like got 17-18% of the senior class taking it. It's called Designing Your Life. It came out of the design school. And it basically just forces the students to reflect on why they are doing what they're doing and not live in a default mode. It's just challenging people to ask those questions about what is worthwhile. Why does love matter so much? Why are relationships so important to me? And how would I live a life well? You know, those things are sort of the type of questions we want to talk about, right? These are the things that, as a university, we as a human community should be able to discuss. And if we have different opinions about this, we should be able to disagree without being disagreeable, right? we are training the next generation of leaders, right? So we should role model a human community that can do that, right? That means we should talk about, why do you believe what you believe? You really believe this guy was raised from the dead? I mean, you should have conversations like that, right? Maybe we're too polite. Or maybe we think that this is kind of like a matter of taste, you know, like cuisine. I like Chinese. You like Chinese too? We gotta pick someone else. Maybe someone, you like Italian? So maybe it's a matter of taste, right? So you can be whatever you want to be. But if, to the extent that some of these worldviews do not have identical claims to assertions, or to the extent that they are different, we should have a conversation about why people believe what they believe. And to the extent that they have commonalities, we should try to see if that makes sense and to see it in different lights. That's what a university ought to be about. You know, of course you have to get a job, you have to learn debits and credits and all that, all these important things in life, but also, you know, it's about doing that, figuring out what this journey is about.
Professor Odean?
Well, I don't know if I have much to follow with. I think actually is it in my role at the university where this probably comes up is I'm now teaching an undergraduate course on personal finance. And I'm actually planning the course with a good friend of mine and Charles Brad Barber up at UC Davis, who's going to teach a similar course there. Brad's my research partner for the last 18 years or so. And one of the things we've been talking about is starting the course off with a discussion of, you know, what's important to you in life and what's the role that money plays in your life, because much of the course is going to be about how to deal with your finances, but we want people thinking that it's not the sole goal is to maximize. In fact, in the personal finance course, I'd say what we're probably more emphasizes how to not make decisions that you later regret. If you want to really know how to make a lot of money, you should take Charles's course.
I don't know about that.
Oh, come on. You have to admit, that is why some of the students take the course, though. The money management course, no?
So managing money is a how-to. Okay. Money, in some sense, is amoral. Okay, that's the way So have you heard the phrase, money is the root of all evil? Yeah. Does it come from the Bible?
No.
Yeah?
No.
Well, it sounds like something that would be from the Bible. I don't know. But it's not, right? The verse is, the love of money is the root of all evil. Okay. So there is a difference. So how is it that we end up loving money? Why is it so important? Well, it's the same reason why you love a good resume, or it just makes you look good. And why is it so important that you look good? Now that is a good question. Where did that come from? Why is it so important that you look good? You know, my little daughter, 5 years old, when she was 5 years old, she came and sat on my lap. She looked in my eyes. She stared like her nose to my nose. And she said, I can see myself in your eyes. She doesn't know how true that is. We see ourselves in the reflections of the eyes around us, and how what we see greatly governs our sense of worth, self-esteem. To me, that's very much related. So this is one reason why, you know, in Genesis 3, there was this, can I talk about this? Okay.
We should probably move on.
Okay, all right.
But you guys were talking about your courses, and I thought it would be the perfect segue to this next question.
Okay. But whatever she has, I'll go back to Genesis 3. Remind me, Genesis 3.
Nothing against Genesis.
Go ahead.
As long as it's the book and not the band. So, okay. So in the financial world, you're both behavioralists, correct? Or so I'm told. Again, my complete ignorance plays into this. Can you briefly explain what that means to the non-HA students in the audience and on the stage, and then reflect on any connections between your stance as behavioralists and your faith perspective? So perhaps, Professor Odean, you can start us off.
Right, I can take it right up to faith perspective, and then I'm handing it over to Charles. All right, so I came back to school at Cal to finish my undergrad degree with the intention of getting a PhD in psychology. And I got to know psychology professor Daniel Kahneman quite well. And when it was getting time to start applying to grad schools, I actually asked him if I could talk to him. He invited me to his house. We had a long conversation. And he convinced me that I should go into finance, get my PhD in finance instead of psychology. And there were a lot of reasons, but the intellectual attraction of going into finance was that the dominant theories in finance at the time were all based on the assumptions that people, economic agents, were very smart, very rational, and very selfish. And my own observation is that the people I knew made a lot of cognitive mistakes and cared about other people. And so really what attracted me to the field was I thought there's probably room for a little innovation and possibly improvement. In that field. And I would say that the behavioral view of people, it's a little more pessimistic on the intellectual side and a lot more optimistic on the humanities side. And that's based, my own personal observation, but there's now, years of research by thousands of behavioral scientists, and we find a lot of things. People care about other people. People care about fairness. We aren't atomistic, selfish beings for the most part. Now, another thing about Danny Kahneman, Danny introduced me to Charles back in 1989. And one other thing about Danny is he won the Nobel Prize in Economics as a psychologist.
All right, so 1989-90, that's actually the year that I got my PhD, and actually the first time I met Terry was actually, I was doing my, what we call the road talk, which is you take your dissertation on the road and you go to different schools and you do your dog and pony show and they decide whether they want to make you an offer. When I got to Berkeley, this fine young man was sitting in the back of the room. After I gave my talk, he came up and invited me home for dinner. I've never had that happen before. When he said, so we went up to his home and we had a really great dinner, he and his wife and his lovely daughters. And that's how our real friendship started. And the reason why Danny Kahneman asked him to come to my workshop was because I was doing behavioral accounting. I was doing behavioral finance / accounting. And Danny wanted to convince him that surrendering a lucrative position as a psychologist to become a finance professor is a viable economic option. He said, look at this guy from Cornell, this hockey puck who's getting all these offers, So that's how we met. Okay, so let me talk a little bit about my own, indoctrination into behavioral finance, which is a few years earlier. I did my PhD, I started my PhD 4 years before that at Cornell. I just graduated from seminary, and I walked into my first classes as a PhD in economics, and all the econ classes were teaching people about what human beings are like, the savage axioms of rationality, which is exactly what Terry said, what the classic teaching was, which is that human beings have infinite processing power, that they are, have utility functions and selfish and so forth. And so I looked at this and I thought, some of this stuff was pretty biblical. I thought selfishness was probably not an unreasonable assumption. But then I looked at this infinite processing power and said, that doesn't look like the guy in Genesis 3, right? So in fact, the guy in Genesis 3 looked nothing like that. So you know, there's one other thing that the guy in Genesis 3 had, which I saw in myself in spades, but I did not see in the economic models, okay? This guy had this very unusual need for self-worth preservation. Okay, what do I mean by that? I mean, you know, I don't know, even if you're not a Christian, you've probably heard the story, Adam and Eve, they ate from a tree, and you know, whatever tree that is, apple or peach, doesn't matter too much. The important thing is they did something that God told them not to do, and then the first thing that happened is their eyes were open, right? Their eyes are open, and what happened right after that? They saw they were naked. And so this is very weird. They were already naked, but suddenly they felt naked. And then God says, the Bible says God walks in the cool of the garden, and God asks man, where are you? Which is a weird thing for God to ask. And then man says, man replies, I am afraid because I am naked, so I hid. You can read that one over and over again because those three emotions are so universal. It doesn't matter where you come from, what culture you are, what faith you are. Those emotions. Fear, I'm afraid. Shame, I'm naked. So I hid. In other words, denial or hiding or efforts to feel less naked. Those things drove my research agenda. Because what does a being do if the being is constantly aware of the fact that he's not sure whether he's worth anything? You know, what's a good... Think about, you know... So think about, you know, what's a good day? A good day is when somebody says something nice. So you can win an award, you win a prize, or, you know, some attractive, you know, person says something that makes you feel like you're attractive. Whatever, right? So why is that so important? Because somehow you just feel like you're worthwhile, right? And what's a bad day? A bad day is when, you know, students give you a lousy evaluation, a car cuts you off. Car cuts you off, it just cuts you off. But you feel like you're threatened. You know, you feel like your self-worth, you know, my self-worth, I don't really want to say you, okay? So my self-worth goes up and down more than the stock price. Why is that? Why is it that every single day we're asking the question, you know, am I worthwhile? Why do I need to affirm that? So when you decide to set those goals, when you look at your resume, when you look at the car you're driving, you look at the girl in your arm, or whatever it is that you're looking for, ask deeper. What are you really looking for? And God has this fantastic question in that conversation in Genesis 3. God says, Adam, who told you you're naked? It's like, he says, Adam, you've always been naked. So... Who told you your name? That is a great question we should ask ourselves today. Do you feel naked? And why? For me, what it means to live in reality is to really look at the creature that we are and ask whether the nature of man that is mirrored in, say, the Gospels or in the scriptures bear some resemblance to the reality of the being that we are. In behavioral economics, right, not only do we have all these cognitive problems, right, people can't process, they have all sorts of problems juggling more complicated gambles. We also have a lot of biases that seem to be related to self-worth preservation. Like, for example, the overconfidence bias. You know, we always think we're more confident than we really should be. The hindsight bias, that is, after something happens, I knew it, you know, I didn't know, well, I knew it. The self-attribution bias, that is, when good things happen, that was me. Bad things happen, you know, stuff happens. There's an incredible number when you actually start running down. All these biases actually prevent us from making better decisions, but so many of them have to do with this, you know. So Terry's dissertation is on this thing called the disposition effect, right?
Right. That and overconfidence.
And overconfidence. So why is this being so prone to making the type of decisions that one makes when one wants to look better than one feels? That's a reasonable question. When, what does that tell us about the veracity of these old writings that we see, you know, that comes from deep, deep roots that tells us something about why we behave the way we behave. Right? I just...
Anyway. You did it. You worked in Genesis 3.
There we go.
I love how you're both happy about that. Okay. So what resources does your worldview or your work offer human beings as they navigate both successes and hardships? Have you ever faced a great personal or professional failure? And what has helped you during that time? Also, what would you say to students who either feel like failures or are driven by a fear of failure generally?
All right, I'll start and we'll get back to Genesis. But, you know, I had a friend who once worked for a company called Baby Watson Cheesecake. And their motto was, if we don't have what you want something else. And I'd like to paraphrase that. And I'd say if any of you sitting here feel that you are a failure, get a new definition of failure. And then ask yourself where your old definition came from. You know, who told you that anything less than a 4.0 average is a failure? Or that not getting into the top medical school is a failure? Or sleeping till 11 o'clock on a Saturday morning is a failure? I actually know who told me. My dad. When I was 16, my dad told me that I was lazy and that I was a dilettante. I believed him for almost 20 years, until my wife finally pointed out to me that I had a lot of negative traits, but laziness wasn't one of them. and that for a 16-year-old boy to be interested in a lot of different things didn't make him a dilettante. So you should ask yourself, where did your ideas of what constitutes a failure and a success come from? Who did they come from? And what do you want to choose? What do you want to choose to define success and failure in your life? Because you should choose, and you should choose very carefully.
It began, what resources does your worldview or your work offer human beings as they navigate both successes and hardships? Have you ever faced a great personal or professional failure? What's helped you during that time? What would you say to students who either feel like failure or are driven by a fear of failure generally?
Okay. So in terms of resources provided by my worldview, I do think that there is a difference between before I was a Christian and after I was a Christian in terms of how I look at success, failure, how I evaluate it, and how I respond to it. I think that before I was a Christian, I think in my most lucid moments, when I'm most quiet and honest and I see the world most clearly, I was kind of melancholy because I see that, you know, all this effort and everything, and then you're just going to die. And you have a worldview that... So I'll leave it at that. After I became a Christian, I think there, in my most lucid moments, in my clearest moments, I do see... I think if I were really honest, I would say I actually am at peace and happy. I feel that in my most clearest moments, I have my ups and downs, and I have good days and I have bad days and all that stuff. In my clearest moments, I'd say everything is good. It's all right. I've gone through various failures and difficult times. I mentioned when I became a Christian, I went through some difficult times. I've had difficulties. If you looked at my resume, you'd think, oh, whoa, he just rolled along. But there were a lot of ups and downs in between. There were times when I wrestled and I struggled with whether I'm even in the right line of work. But I think it really helped me to know that I have been loved by the most lovable being, the most worthwhile being there could ever be. If you have been so loved, it is transformational. It does not matter quite so much whether I get tenure at Stanford or whether it does not matter quite so much. And I would tell you, if that's related to this idea that if you today, tonight, you feel like you're a failure or that you're wrestling with the fear of failure, I guess the main thing I would try to communicate to you is that, you know, the one that loves you is not going to judge you by your resume or by how you performed. The one that really knows you, the love that really, really matters, is not judging on the basis of that. And that's actually the thing that matters the most for me now. And I think you may find something like that in your own life.
I sense a little bit of a conspiracy here, because you two seem to be in agreement on a lot of these issues.
True.
Except for...
You want to pick a fight?
Yeah. It's been a really long time since I've read Genesis 3.
Long time. But it seems that because I was the
so
question.
So maybe I can pick a fight.
To...
So why has it been such a long time, Terry?
Why has it been such a long time? Because
it's, you don't have to answer that.
We used to have an hour every day when we were. Nah, it's less than an hour, but some amount of time every day where we
when
were
supposed to
do spiritual reading, and there were. I learned eventually that the definition of spiritual reading could be stretched a bit. But I started off thinking that it was only reading the Bible, so I basically spent a lot of time for the first couple of years in the seminary reading the Bible. And then there are a lot of things that I don't... You know, I sometimes think they're not reading the Bible, there are two things that I did enough in the early part of my life to satisfy me. One was eating potatoes. And we had potatoes at every evening meal and Sunday dinner for my entire childhood. And the other for me was going to Mass, which I did 6 or 7 days a week until I was, you know, from the time I was 6 to 17. So it's just been a while since, yeah.
So we're going to agree on some things again.
Well, we do, okay.
It's a little worried. When I was first going to church, my mom took me. She took me because she was a Christian, and we were bratty. And, you know, church, we were supposed to behave a little better. I remember that in my Bible, I would have my Chinese kung fu novel or whatever it was. And I went to church because my mom wanted me to go to church, and... it looked like a Bible from the outside, you know, but you know, for me, it was just a second coming, you know, the second encounter that sort of very dramatically changed my perspective on the value of it. And for me, I feel that the change in my life was an exogenous shock.
It's finance talk.
By that I mean it was not something of self-conception. It's something that you could actually conceive of yourself. A lot of people say it would be nice to have faith, but you know, if I can convince myself to believe, I could like self-hypnotize, then good things happen. It's good to have faith, but I'm not, you know, I can't do that. Well, I can't do that either. I really feel like something happened to me. I feel like that I encountered God. And I feel that through that process, there were a lot of things that seemed impossible to me before, like understanding the Bible, like actually reading it for more than 2 minutes and still felt like it was worth continuing, which was totally the way I was. Like, I liked the Christians. I thought they were nice people. They were a little slow, but they were nice people. And I would go to the Bible studies. I would ask a few polite questions. I'd realize that they didn't have answers, and I went away satisfied because I figured that was my prior. But when after I became Christian, when I read the Bible, I couldn't put it down. I was saying, did he really say that? Did he really say that? Why would he say that? And how could it be that I couldn't understand or see or want to know it before? To me, that was some sort of exogenous event that caused me to suddenly, you know, be able to read something that was Greek to me. For me, that was part of the change that started at 24 that has continued to roll.
Yeah, I didn't get that event. In fact, I believe why I went to the seminary was I was having doubts about, you know, God and religion, and I was sort of hoping that the priest would talk me back into believing so that I wouldn't have to tell my mother that I was an atheist and leaving the church, which was something I dreaded for years because, you know, I was 15-year-old boy. And, you know, since then, there are parts that, I guess my feeling is, as a Roman Catholic, there's a lot of history there for the Roman Catholics. It ain't all good. Some's good, some bad. What I strongly believe in is that we have to live together, tolerate people, and embrace people who think differently and live differently, and that religious belief can be a tool towards that, and it's sometimes used as destructively.
Yeah, so I totally agree with that. I really do think that it can be very divisive. I do think also that if we took it seriously, though, we should be able to have conversations about why we believe what we believe. I have conversations, animated ones, with my children about this. God doesn't force us to believe, and we don't coerce our children either. So we get really good conversations, I tell my daughter, you know, my faith is evidence-based, and she says, it's not evidence-based. I said, well, if I'm really, like, not being scientific, could you, like, try to save me? Like, tell me why? And we have these conversations. I think these are reasonable conversations to have. I think that religion can become a tool for division, for exclusivity, but they need not be. And somewhere in this world, a community of human beings should role model how it's like to have conversations about the most important questions we can ask as human beings without being divisive. Don't you think we should start here? Don't you think that universities is where we should have these conversations? Shouldn't we, like, teach people what a human community ought to look like and still ask the questions that should matter? I think we should. I mean, you probably have it in your dorm rooms, in your hallways, in your bars anyway. So we should just have it in a more public setting. C'est bien? Hey?
So you say we should teach courses.
Well, we don't have to necessarily teach courses. I think it would be great to teach courses. I heard there was a good one coming out. What was it? Do you want me to do a promotion? Who said it?
We're not done with the questions.
Okay.
Let's stick to the program here.
What's that?
So we're sticking to the program. Yeah.
There are only a couple. So for many people, especially in the university, success and happiness are closely connected. Hmm. What is the relationship between success and happiness? Or what is the relationship of success to happiness? What insight has your professional work and personal experience lent to answering the question, how does one best go about finding happiness?
Well, I don't think any of my research applies directly, other than that you shouldn't trade too much. really, I wrote a paper called Trading is Hazardous to Your Wealth, taken under advisement. So I guess I only have personal experience to go on, which it's sort of, I think, the obvious things, which is if you want to be happy, make and keep friends who you love and respect and who love and respect you. Try to find work that you enjoy and that you feel that is meaningful and that you're good at. Think a little bit every day about, take a little time to think about the things in your life that you're grateful for. There are a few other things like that, but I'm not remembering what I was going to say. But, you know, it's not rocket science, and it's actually not a big secret. Back in my hippie days, which we're not going to discuss in any great detail, I once went with some friends. I was the only one with a van. We were down in Southern California. And they wanted to go and hear this yogi and guru give a talk. And we went and heard the talk, and my friends were really disappointed because they were hoping to learn something, you know, kind of esoteric, something sort of special that the rest of the world didn't know. Well, what this guy said was basically, he said, just love other people. And then he actually had the audacity to say, yeah, if you have time, do some yoga. But that's not what's most important. What's most important is to love the people around you and treat them well. And I know you hear it a lot, but in the end, it's your relationships that are going to make or break your life.
That's great. Yeah, so yes, relationships. Yeah, I think relationships are more important than tasks. Relationships are more important than things. Things are supposed to serve people. So I think we all agree on that. In terms of relationships, for me, the first relationship is the one with your creator. So that is a relationship. If there is a personhood of God, then that is a relationship. If there isn't, then of course that's just, you know, make-believe. But if there is, then that is a first-order relationship, which has ramifications for all the other relationships. In terms of happiness, the relationship between happiness and success, so I think we actually chatted about this over dinner, too. So there's a fair bit of research that looks at where happiness comes from, and the fact that people who try to be happy are actually, as it turns out, empirically not as happy as people who try to live, as Professor Odean said, live a more meaningful life, right? Something that has purpose. And the way I would summarize it is to say the pursuit of happiness cannot be separated from the pursuit of virtue. Okay, the pursuit of happiness cannot be separated. Everybody wants to be happy, but what does it mean to be happy? Even everybody wants to love other people, but what does it mean to love other people? You have to wrestle with the more amorphous and difficult issue, which is, what is goodness? What is good? What does it mean to be good, to be virtuous? Because if you pursue happiness without wrestling with that more difficult question about goodness and virtue, you will end up in a corner in which you have, a very selfish corner in which you have neither. And so you always ultimately have to come back to asking questions about right and wrong. And more difficult questions, an even more difficult question, is not what is right and what is wrong, which is already more difficult than asking how do I be happy, okay? The more difficult question is, why am I not as right as I can see I should be? Okay, what is it that's preventing me from doing the things that my moral reasoning tell me I should do? For me, these are very important clues. You know, in London, right? In London, when you get on the subway, you always hear this thing, mind the gap. Mind the gap. And in Hong Kong, too, right? Mind the gap. Why? Because their subways are so old that there's the trains and the stations and platforms have big gaps in between, right? Mind the gap. So you have to watch out for the gap. In your life, too, mind the gap. Because the gap tells you a lot about where you come from, why you're here. The gap between, the distance between your moral reasoning and your moral conduct is a big clue about, you know, grander aspirations like harmonious society and more just society. It's reasonable to ask. For me, my life changed that one evening when they were doing a Bible study, and the verse that hit me was this verse from the Bible, from Romans 3:23, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Right? All have sinned. I just remember one thing. I mean, most of the stuff just sounded like silliness to me, but this all have sinned, I thought all means everyone. Everyone includes me as a proper subset. It said, I have sinned. And somehow, that proposition stuck. I thought that it was not insane. It was the first thing that came out of the Bible that I thought was not insane. And out of that, the whole spool started to unravel for me. Okay, so.
Thank you so much to you both. So I think at this stage, we're ready to open it up for our Q&A session. And I heard that people would be texting me things, I mean, related to this forum. Okay, so first, the first question, I'm not sure who it's from. So for Professor Odean, when someone has failed in a certain endeavor, didn't get into med school, didn't get a job, lost a job, what advice would you give them if they were to say they lost their purpose?
All right. So there are a couple aspects to that sort of thing. I mean, it actually happened to my daughter. My daughter wanted to go to med school, and she fell in love with an Australian lad that she met in a youth hostel in Florence, and ended up moving to Australia and doing her undergrad at Australia. And she didn't realize that probably a majority of the U.S. med schools wouldn't take an applicant from someone who didn't have a U.S. degree. So she was. Didn't get into med school and was talking to she's working in a neuroscience lab in Emeryville, and was talking to the doctor and professor she worked with, who said, well, you'd be a great doctor, but you'd be a great scientist too. And suddenly she realized, actually, that's what I want to be, as a scientist. Now she's getting a PhD in neuroscience at Columbia, and she's very happy that she didn't go to med school. Now, I'm not suggesting that every time something doesn't work out, that's for the better. But it's probably not the only thing that matters. And sometimes we have the equivalent of failures that are close to the only thing. You know, you lose a spouse, you lose someone dies who's very close to you, which has something in common with failing for something really important to you. And most of us do recover and life goes on, but that's where community and friends and if probably faith for those who have it are helpful, knowing. And in probably a less than profound but sort of true way, even good habits in life. When I have had some failures, I found that when I went outside, I used to run, and I would run or just even take a walk, it would change my perspective. That getting, I'd wake up in the morning and yeah, it still hurt a lot, but less so. So I'm not trying to say every failure doesn't matter, it probably does. Deaths of close loved ones certainly matter, but there's still meaning in our in our lives, and often with specific goals, we probably overemphasize how important that particular success is.
Thank you. And here's another one. It's not addressed to either anybody in particular. How can you talk more about the ultimate goal of our lives? A common life goal of secular people is happiness. Why, in the Christian perspective, is this not the right goal to have?
That's probably for you, Charles.
I like to be happy. I much prefer happy to being unhappy. But when you think about what we mean by happiness, usually we think of it as some sort of a feeling. It's sort of usually some sort of external circumstance change, people, things around you, and you have this impulse, this response of happiness. It's nothing wrong with that, but I think it tends to be very transitory, very temporary. It is a feeling. And I think that if you think a little deeper about when you feel those things and in a more structural way, why there are times when you feel happy and not happy, and that's what a lot of research does, they discover that people who have a purpose in life tend to be happier than people who are, you know, who aren't focused on being happy. And to have purpose, you have to have a context. You have to have a sense of where you've been, where you're going, a sense of direction, and a sense that I am part of something more important than myself. Right? So I think that's part of it. I think just one more thing. I think that there is something that the Bible talks about, which is not happiness. It's more like wellness. Okay, it's like, you know, Jesus says, blessed are. Blessed sounds like it's happy are, but it's not really happy. It's wellness. It's like, you know, Kaiser Permanente, they have this commercial, be well, you know, thrive, be well. And, you know, Stanford has a health plan called wellness. So this is a wellness of the soul. That's a condition of the soul. It is not dependent on external circumstances. Okay, and not that it's unaware of external circumstances, but it's just a condition. It's just a health condition of a soul. And that is less ephemeral, less transitory than happiness, and is less dependent on whether you just got a publication or won an award. And that is something to aspire to. And that wellness of the soul has something to do with, you know, how you connect with your Creator, at least in my worldview.
So I'm also supposed to let people know that you can't, if somebody in the audience didn't text in, wants to ask a question, there are two mics in the aisles that you can line up, and we'll also take your questions. But I do have more text-ins. So this one is for Professor Odean. How did you transition from being in seminary to becoming an atheist? What kind of experience or knowledge led you to believe that no God exists?
Okay. I think it's pretty much just how I am and how I think. So I know it started way before that. I know I was in sixth grade, and we would have the assistant pastor would come in once a week to teach religion class. And one week he came, as he was leaving, he said, next week I'm going to tell you the 10 proofs for the existence of God. And I spent the week thrilled because I was having doubts, which created a lot of emotional tension because of the, you know, my parents were, mother in particular, so religious. I thought, yes, he's. And he showed up the next week and started listing them. And like, no, no, no. And he pretty much got through the 10 proofs, and they weren't proofs. I had a pretty good sense. I still have a pretty good sense of what constitutes a proof. So for me, that was basically, you know, that was it. And I spent the next few years trying to reverse what I kind of knew was where things were going. And I don't think I understand that people have faith, but I have no desire to dislodge anyone's faith. If someone thinks that they can prove the existence of God, that's fine. But as a proof, it probably won't hold up to my ideas of proof. And I don't think faith needs to be based on proof.
Can I jump in?
All right. I think it's time, proof. Charles.
It's time. All right, proof. So let's think about what a proof is, right? A proof, mathematically, undergrads in mathematics, right? Mathematically, a proof is when you start with some axiomatic assumptions. Axiomatic, so they're not to be challenged, so they're axiomatic. You follow a series of irrefutable rules of logic, okay, irrefutable, and you get to an inescapable conclusion, okay, and that's a proof, okay, right? That's a proof. Now, when it comes to the existence of God, I wouldn't dare to come up with proofs, okay, but I would also argue proofs are not what we need. Because in the most important decisions of your life, you will not do so because there's a proof. You will do so under some uncertainty. So if under certainty, we will all make the same decisions. That's what certainty is. But under uncertainty, when you observe the behavior of someone, you begin to discover who they are. And it turns out that that's the way God works. It turns out that he doesn't coerce us, he doesn't bribe us, he doesn't train us to force us to make a decision. He leaves it under some amount of uncertainty. And then you find out in your heart what really, really matters. So I would put it this way. Think about the most important decisions you've made in your life. What are those up to this point? Maybe choosing Berkeley is and pretty important, right? You know, you had other choices and you decided to come to Berkeley. So you didn't have a proof for that, at least not a mathematical one. You just bet on it based on weight of evidence. You know, this is a better school than that. I was thinking that that new quarterback was going to be better than he thought he was going to be. But whatever, you have reasons for choosing, right? They gave me the best scholarship. My girlfriend went. Those are all good reasons. You use weight of evidence. I cannot math my wife. Where's Lily? Where are you? So she's over there. So my wife's over there. So I cannot mathematically prove that Lily loves me. But I'm betting my whole life on it, right? I cannot mathematically prove. I just flew back from Pittsburgh. I cannot mathematically prove that the plane that took me here wouldn't have fallen out of the sky. But I bet my life on it. We're making these decisions all the time. And in fact, in the matters of love relationships, in all these most important parts of life, we're not using proof. We're using weight of evidence. So now then the issue is there sufficient weight of evidence for the existence of God, for the veracity of the claims of the Bible? Those are the reasonable questions, right? And in my view, there is. And then you have to ask, why is that hockey puck like that? Well, that's the kind of conversation we can have, right?
Yeah, Korea, people ask me at times, well, why don't you say you're agnostic instead of atheist? And it's almost the same answer, which is, you know, somebody said to me, well, how do you know there's an Antarctica? You've never been to Antarctica, and, you know, with Photoshop, I mean, who knows? You know, they've been Photoshopping those Antarctica shots for years. And yet, I don't spend a lot of time doubting the existence of Antarctica. For me, you know, it's possible. Probably there. And I no longer spend time asking myself, well, am I wrong about my atheism? You know, yeah. It's the same thing. For me, the answer is clear.
Why? Why is that? No, I'm really... No. So atheism... real concept. So atheism is the assertion that God does not exist. Is that right, or is that not?
The assertion. I don't care to assert. I just don't. I believe God doesn't exist.
You believe that God doesn't exist.
I'm only asserting for me. I mean, other words, I don't proselytize my atheism.
Okay.
Just
reasonable.
Like, you know, I grew up in a proselytizing... You know, my uncle went off to be a missionary, and I just I'm content with my own atheism. Okay,
right. But you're very enthusiastic, for example, about behavioral finance, right? Do you apostatize?
I'm enthusiastic about all sorts of things.
Right, right.
But someone at the gym this morning told me I was too cheerful.
Right, right. So what I mean is,
okay.
Right. So help me. So if I am an atheist, it means that I assert God does not exist. But I can't prove he doesn't exist, right? Because it takes a certain amount of faith to believe that he doesn't exist, because all I can say is I haven't encountered him, right?
I can't even prove Antarctica exists.
Right, right. So
we both agree that every time we get up into an airplane, it's an act of faith.
Right, right, right. So what I mean is, when it comes to the existence of God, right, doesn't it take some faith to believe that he doesn't exist? Doesn't it take a certain amount of sort of commitment to something else? So for example, if my commitment is that the world of energy and matter is all there is, right? And this God thing doesn't fit into my experience in the world of energy and matter, then axiomatically, because my axiomatic assumption is that there is only energy and matter, then God doesn't exist. Is that reasonable?
That's not my view, is that yours?
No, what I'm saying is that would be a coherent, that would be consistent, right? But what would it be? I'm really trying to understand. So all atheists, could you raise your hand? So I'm trying to understand what it means. I'm trying to understand why. Because I think it takes a certain amount of faith, right, to be an atheist.
A certain amount of what?
Faith. Would you have to?
I don't really think so. So first of all, like you talk about the world of energy and matter, I don't at all have the sense that
that's all there is.
That I know what there is. I mean, okay. I may be famous people get misquoted all the time. So this might be a misquote, but I believe Einstein once said that the world's stranger than we imagine. Indeed, it's stranger than we can imagine. That, I believe. Mm-hmm. So there's certainly a lot that we
don't know.
It's
also possible
God works
in mysterious
ways. To think that you know that you do know everything. I guess I would just view it as, if you were to introduce there could be a God, mm-hmm. then there would be certainly a wide variety of descriptions of that God, mm-hmm. right? And if you actually believed in one, it would to some extent be to the exclusion of others. And why is it that you don't believe, say, in a Hindu God? I mean, in some extent, this is on a par. We view certain things, I guess, as a stat major, I'd say probabilistically, this is a sufficiently low probability event for me that I'd lead my life without it. And for me, it probably doesn't change my life much, even though it changed your life a lot. I kind of think I left my religion. I rejected the dogma, and a lot of the practice hung around.
Yeah. Okay. That's good. So
shall we
move on? You want me to move on?
Maybe
move on. Okay.
All right.
I'm not
gonna
get
this
converted
isn't great,
tonight.
But yeah. So the person at the mic.
Hi, my name is Brittany. I really appreciate your words and your commentary tonight. Thank you. I do have a question, just to kind of give in a challenge to this idea of the American dream, I guess. Earlier, Professor Odean, like you talked about, you know, the bummer out statistics of, you know, inequality and social mobility in our nation. And as a low income first generation college student, you know, the American dream is something that is kind of confounds me. I feel like historically, the American dream has been packaged for a certain type of peoples with certain amounts of privilege. My parents immigrated from Ghana in Africa, and they weren't able to, you know, make the American dream happen. And so, you know, it's kind of, you know, it's, I guess I feel like it's not very intersectional, the term the American Dream, at how it affects different groups and communities in America, and really acknowledging the diversity and life experiences that go on in this country. And especially as a Black American, you know, and the ways in which, you know, African Americans have been and are continually oppressed in this system, and how, like, you know, and just like the disdain for the poor that America has in general, you know, how like, oh, poor people, they did this to themselves, they don't make any financial decisions, you know, they just need to pick themselves up by their bootstraps and, you know, make it happen kind of thing, and not really acknowledging the structures of normality that contribute to their oppression. And even going deeper, you know, and how, like, you know, stereotypes and ideologies of, you know, shame and, you know, dislike and blatant hate, you know, shape the ways in which, you know, people from poor communities are able to engage with the world. You talked about, you know, this idea of, you know, just shrugging off those ideals, and or at least both of you talked about this idea of, you know, shrugging off these ideals and coming to a definition for yourself. But I would argue that if you are given very real limitations as to what you can attain in this world, you know, how can you go beyond the confines by which society tells you that you are nothing, you know? And likewise, you know, how do people in places of privilege, you know, allow to truly love on these people and not say, oh, well, I got my privilege, so, you know, it's all their fault, and I want to keep my happiness, so, you know, I'm gonna not do anything about it, you know, and let them fester in their suffering because they deserve it. And I guess, like, you know, this theme of, you know, radically loving someone, I'm also a Christian, you know, I'm constantly confounded by people who say that they believe in God, but are so, you know, angry at the fact that Black people are speaking out about their suffering, or, you know, people who are oppressed and, you know, are of the same religion and, you know, find it okay and justified that they are in this place. I just wanted to know your thoughts on, like, how to, you know, I guess, redefine the American Dream, since it's kind of built on a, you know, 200 years of oppression and blood and death of, you know, the original inhabitants of these people, and, you know, the enslavement of, you know, a particular populace to make sure that certain people had wealth and other people didn't.
I'll talk it. Answer a little, you can answer a little. So, yeah, it's kind of, there's not much disagreement here, though, right? I mean, what I was trying to say earlier is, you know, that the American Dream, it was never true that people could move up, you know, that people could succeed regardless of their social and economic class, that it was an even playing field, and it probably never will be. There were times in our history where it was more true, although probably not more true for all people, and certainly in the 1800s when, you know, it was not for the most part true for Black Americans. Part of the point I wanted to make is that it's actually been getting worse, not better. And the optimistic side was that one of the mechanisms or channels that still works is public education and the public universities. And to some extent, you represent both parts of what you're talking about, because you said your parents came from Ghana, and here you are, you're a student here. Yes? Mm-hmm. So you're a student at the best public university in the world. And that's a good thing. That is part of this dream, or more of an aspiration, that of for a world or a country in which people succeed through a meritocracy, but also one where everybody's treated more equally. And it's true. It's more of an aspiration, and it's one that's been slipping away, certainly since Ronald Reagan became president. Yeah.
Yeah. So I wouldn't be here to defend the history of wrongs that have been done here, or either as a church or as a society in America, and I think that we all see things that we ought to do better today. I would also point out, though, that there are a lot of people in the world who want to come here because of the opportunity that it continues to present. So, in an iconic sense, when people talk about the American dream in its noblest sense, okay, it is like Terry said, it is an aspiration towards something that we want to be, rather than what we already are. And I think that that's not an all bad thing. It gives us something to work towards. And where we see things that aren't going right, we should be speaking up. And you know, the election is coming, there's a lot of that going on, so it's good.
For more information about the Veritas Forum, including additional recordings and a calendar of upcoming events, please visit our website at veritas.org.